Okay. Had a little technical difficulty with our projector, so we're just gonna go to the books.
No, Papa, let me help you. I help you.
Okay, everybody find I Feel Like Traveling On. This is a good song for us to do. You got a free hand you can clap? All right.
Thank you.
Shining good today. The unclouded day. This is a good song, but it's short, so we may do it twice. How about that? All right. I was thinking of those last two songs, that one, that we're going to have a place to live for eternity where there's no going to be any rain or clouds. You know, that's the original way God set up the Garden of Eden. There was no rain, was there? They didn't have to wake up and think, we can't do anything today. Right? They just woke up and just went. And the last one that we sang, it talked about joining the host of heaven. Did you know that the angels praise God around the throne of God, right?
Amen.
But did you know that they can't sing the songs that you can sing? Did you know that?
Oh, wow, yeah.
You know why? Because you can sing the songs of the redeemed, and they have not been redeemed. Right? Isn't that something? You can sing, as a Christian, special songs about being redeemed by the blood of Jesus. They don't sing those songs.
That's right.
Isn't that something? But you can sing songs that even the angels can't sing because they're special for you.
Right.
Amen.
Amen.
Somebody look through and find us our last song. First one you call out.
Prince of Peace.
Prince of Peace? Okay. Prince of Peace. Last one in your book.
Is that a good key for everybody?
You are holy. Is that a good key?
Yes.
All right. Remember, we got the boys' part and the girls' part. How many boys we got in here? Let me see your hands. How many girls? Right. I'm glad y'all are not confused because so many people are today, aren't they? We got people here that know that they're boys and girls. Okay, you could be seated. You know, when we have technical difficulties, like a projector, or a car breakdown, or the guitar string breaks. You know what I mean? When you have those kind of things, just go say, okay, we'll do something else. Because sometimes God wants you to do something else, right? Sometimes it's all about not worrying about it. Follow the movement of the Holy Spirit. Amen?
Amen.
We need to remember that. So we got offering this morning? No offering? Okay. Prayer request. We want to remember Charlotte and who else has been sick? I know we've had some prayer. And keep me in prayer. I'm going to put myself down. I went to the doctor this week, and I'm being treated for three things he said it could be. And so we'll see after the medicine's gone if I got a sinus infection or something else. Amen?
Amen.
I also got new glasses. I've saved them. I put my new glasses on, hoping that some of my vision problems will be better with some better glasses. You like my glasses, Leo? Leo likes my glasses. Anybody notice I had new glasses on?
I did.
Did you, Ellie? All right. That Canaan did. Okay. So who else has got prayer requests?
I'm going to continue to lift Letitia up.
Letitia, okay.
Suzanne Chanis has been in a season of difficulty with her neuralgia.
Okay, Suzanne.
I know friends of ours that are up in the northern part of the country have been through a blizzard.
Okay.
Bad snow and ice. And we have quite a few folks that join us that are from those areas.
Okay. Mr. Rob, I guess Haley would give a report on that.
Yeah, Mr. Rob.
He's home, I think. Okay.
Well, wait. We can just wait a minute or two while
sure.
folks post up.
Sure.
How about?
Oh.
The Casey's.
Casey. Okay. Oh, the Casey family.
Yes.
Okay. Casey family. Because I know a Casey too. Casey family.
We can pray for that Casey family.
And that's right. Casey will remember her. I went through this list that we will remember their family members who are lost. We've got some family members that are away from God, and we want to remember, ask that God just bring them back. Sometimes you don't have to give all the details because God knows what's going on, doesn't he?
Yes, he does.
We're praying for everybody's gardens, too. Sometimes
we're
playing season. Garden.
Yes. We've had a tremendous amount of rain this past winter. It's been bad, and it's going to be rough to garden this year, and we produce a lot of our own food, so we need to pray that God will work the weather out. I remember years ago when we had wet, I think a couple of summers, we didn't grow anything but weeds. We couldn't get into the rows. It grew waist high. I remember one time we've actually got pictures of all the girls when they were younger, covered in mud, out there knee deep in mud, trying to pull weeds out, just trying to get things to grow. We should have grown rice that year. You know, it was just a wet, wet year. But just pray that our families can grow what we need.
Carol asked for prayer for a young mother at their church diagnosed with Lyme disease, and
okay.
She's pregnant. With her fifth child, so.
Okay.
Her name's Becca.
Becca, okay. We'll pray for Becca. Thank you, Carol. I appreciate people mentioning someone in prayer. That means they're on your heart. And that's the way we're supposed to be as Christians. We're supposed to carry each other's burdens, right?
I know Lenny and Gary have been sick and we need to lift them in prayer.
Okay, Lenny and Gary. Eleanor had that virus.
Yeah.
Not this Eleanor, another Eleanor. And I think her husband.
Just need to pray her children don't get it.
Yes. Paul?
Our nation.
Our nation. Amen.
Not very happy right now.
You know, there's several scriptures that talk about when God wants to judge a nation, he sends bad rulers in. You know, he sends in evil kings. Babylon overcame Israel. Israel was God's people, and Babylon overcame them, and they were taken into exile, and families really broken up and destroyed, all because of their sin. I want to pray that just from a personal level that I can get my life better with God. Amen?
Amen.
How many of you would admit that you could be closer to God, but you're just not? Raise your hand if you say, I really could be closer to God. Everybody could be. You know, when I have my annual reviews at work, one of the things, I'm at the end of my career, but one of the things I remember through the years is you can always do better. You can always improve. Don't just go with the status quo, which is the same thing every day, what everybody else is doing. You know, so-and-so, what do you think you can do better at? What he said, what she said, right? Think about your own life. What can you do better in, right? What can we do better in? So I want you to pray that your life would be called on by God, and that your family would be called on by God, and in doing so, your community would be called on by God, and in your town be called on by God, and in your state, and then your country. Amen?
Amen?
Guess where it starts with? Starts with us, doesn't it? We've heard a lot of reports of revival in some places. Revival's great, but sometimes you do that, you do that thing where you share it, that, oh, well, God's working. Why isn't he working with us? I don't want to know about a revival in South Korea. I don't want to know about a revival in Kentucky. I want to know about a revival in my home, in my family. Mm-hmm. So many times we've heard of revivals in the past, and then afterwards, nothing changes in the church.
Amen.
Right? Church members still nearly 50% get divorced. Church members still falling away. 70% of the people, I told us last week, 70% of people that said they were Christians, 70% of people that say they're Christians believe that there's other ways to heaven. Then you're not a Christian if you believe there's other ways to heaven, because the Bible says there's only one way to heaven, and that's Jesus. Right?
Amen.
So we need to make sure that the revival begins with us. Is there any more prayer needs before I go into the prayer? Okay, let's go to the Father today. Father, we lift up these needs to you today, and there's so many of them are sick. Lord, they're sick in body. Lord, they're stressed in their minds. Their hearts have been weakened. Lord, some hearts have been broken. There's people on this list, Lord, that are in distress. There are people here, Father, that need a touch from you, a mental touch, a spiritual touch, a physical touch. And I ask that you be with them today and touch them in that way. Lord, I pray for those with the greatest need, and that is salvation. Those that we mentioned on here that need their life turned around and need to be saved. Father, those that are on the hearts of those praying with us right now, they may not be on my list. Their name may not be mentioned here, but you know that person. And you know when we call out to you, Lord, it bothers us. It certainly bothers you when someone has fallen away from God and left the church, Lord. We ask, Lord, that they would be restored to you, that the walls would come down, and that hearts would be softened, and that situations would change, Father, so that those people are not happy in their sin. Make them miserable in their sin, Lord. Let them be in a position that you do whatever it takes to bring them back to you and the fold and back to the cross, Lord. I just pray, Father, that you be with our nation. Let it be a place where it begins with us and the changes. Change us, Lord. Help us to call out to you and not be waiting on someone else to start revival, not be waiting on someone else to make a change in the nation. Lord, help us to stand up as men and women of God and do the things that we have to do, the things that are hard, Lord. We ask, Father, that you touch those in the path of storms and those in the path of economic storms that are coming. Lord, many of us have already suffered the economic strain in our economy. I pray that you would take care of your people, Lord, and that you would provide for our needs. Lord, as we see things that need to change, it may not change for us, Lord, but I just ask that you would give us grace to understand that no matter what, you will take care of your people. We thank you, Father, that even though the garden may not grow, that you will take care of the food for your people, Lord. And we thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. I'm going to move the microphone up. Sorry, I didn't have that up here earlier. I'm in James chapter 3 this week. James 3. Not a long passage today, but one that has depth. When you think about depth in something, let's say you owned 100 acres and you wanted to farm 30 acres. That's a pretty large percent of your land, isn't it? And in doing that, you get tractors and plows and things that you need to plow that. And you're covering a lot of area, but you're not going very deep, are you? Now let's assume that right behind your house, you start digging a well. Modern well digging uses a machine, a big truck that is backed up and a tower stood up and a drill going down. And Andy, would you hand show us what size a well is at your house? What diameter? About this big around, about a foot in diameter. And there's a pipe there, isn't there? And that well is not very big on the whole piece of property, is it? I mean, you've got 100 acres in my scenario, and you're only dealing with this much. But oh, how important that well is, right? Without that well, Andy and his family can't live on that property, right? Got to go deep. Got to go deep for the water. So I want you to think about the Word of God that way. It's not how many books of the Bible you memorize. It's not how many scriptures you memorize. It's not how many times you can quote the tribes of Israel or the apostles or any of the other things that we remember as sort of trivia out of the Bible. That's good to know that stuff. But what kind of depth do you know in the Bible? Right? Think about the depth that you have. When you study it and you skim through it or reading, most of you have had a reading plan for the Bible. You've had some way to read through the Bible. If you hang around here long enough, you'll hear a lot of it. You hear it. You may not go home and read it again, but you hear it. You hear me read it to you. You may have heard online messages, and you hear the Bible, but have you drilled it? Have you gone deep in it? Have you taken that one passage or that one subject or that one thing that you need to be working on and gone for the water? See, most of us have not done that. We've not dealt with the water of the Word. We've dealt with skimming the surface. You know, well, I've walked over this piece of property. I kind of know it. But have you known the depth of it? So I want you to consider the depth of the Word of God today. And we're in James 3, 13 through 18, the last of that chapter. And we're looking at wisdom, and my message is called Wisdom from Above. Wisdom from Above. When you consider someone being wise, what is the image that you get? A wise person? Anybody? What do you think about somebody wise? Paul?
A man who is, he's been well educated, he's gone to many schools, he's gone to college, he's had a degree in every single thing that you can think about.
Okay, so he's trained, he's got knowledge, he's had past experiences. And Angie, you was going to say something?
An older person,
right? So time gives experience and wisdom, right? Anybody else? Right. Very good. And that's actually one of our passages today. Very good, Ben. That's right. That's right. Even Leo knows about that. Yeah.
Knows the way.
Knows the way, right? So there's different kinds of wisdom than we think about it. And there's different ways that wisdom come to us. One person said through time, an older person, right? And Polly said through schooling or training, you took education and got this. That's how we get wisdom. We learn a lot of wisdom on how what to do because we failed and did the wrong thing, right? So a lot of our positive things in life, we get from mistakes we made in life. But today we're looking at, there's two kinds of wisdom. You see, there's a lot of people that have the wisdom of this world. They are smart in the world's wisdom. They're not smart in God's wisdom. Today we're looking at the wisdom from above, which is obviously God's wisdom, isn't it? It's the kind of wisdom we learn when we study the Word, when we fellowship with God, when we're, like even somebody said, just through time. We learn something. We tried this, it didn't work. Let's read through our passage today in James 3:13. Who is a wise man and endued with knowledge among you? That was my first question. What do you think about when you think about a wise person? Some of you may have somebody in mind, a particular person. You think, that's a wise man or woman. You think they're wise. James continues, let him show out of a good conversation his works with meekness of wisdom. But if you have bitter envy and strife, envying and strife in your hearts, glory not and lie not against the truth. This wisdom descendeth not from above, but is earthly, sensual, devilish. For where envying and strife is, there is confusion in every evil work. But the wisdom that is from above is first pure, then peaceable, gentle, easy to be entreated, full of mercy and good fruits, without partiality and without hypocrisy. And the fruit of righteousness is sown in peace of them that make peace. So today we're looking at the wisdom from above. The wisdom from above. Now, James starts off and says, who's a wise man and a dude with knowledge among you? So knowledge does give wisdom, doesn't it? That's one of the elements of wisdom. But that's not the only thing. There's a lot of educated people in the world that are really not wise. Right? A lot of people go get high degrees in college, have high levels of education. They know things you and I don't know, and they are not wise. We see it all the time, don't we? We see people whose families fall apart, but yet they might have a master's degree in something. We hear people that are supposed to be the leaders of this country or the elected leaders of this country, and they really are like, seriously? You don't know the difference between a woman and a man? Right? No wisdom. Let him show out of a good conversation his works with meekness of wisdom. Now, I've said this before. I'll tell you every time I read the word conversation, it is not about discussing between, you know, like Ellie and I have a conversation. That's not what conversation means. A conversation is a Greek word, and that's anastrophe means manner of life, conduct, or behavior. So it actually means your life, the way you live, not what you're saying necessarily, that too, but not just a conversation like Ellie and I might have, but it is your life or your manner of living. So he says, let him show out of a good conversation, out of a good life, his works with meekness of wisdom. So the works that you have portray your wisdom. If someone goes around and they say,
I'm a very wise man. My first reaction is shake my head thinking, you're probably not, because you just told me you were wise. You think you're wise, because when you're wise, you may not even think about it as that, but your wisdom shows out in the way you live, and other people pick up on that. Case in point, you're praying with somebody or talking with somebody in discussion, and in the middle of it, you just say something that just makes sense. Maybe you've seen it before and you're helping them, and maybe God just prompts you or some way, and that person goes, yes. Anybody ever had that happen? You help somebody by talking to them, and right? I mean, I know some of you have, because that's the wisdom of God. That's not your wisdom. And even things that you didn't even realize you said had that big of an importance, but to them it did, or something that you said, they jump back and say, yes. You see, they was looking for something, and you just gave God the glory because you didn't even know you had it, right? That's the wisdom of God. Is it's not self-seeking, right? It's not something you think, I'm a pretty good pastor. No. Because people of God that are wise, it's just part of them, right? Let him show it out of a good conversation, his works with meekness of wisdom. Now, the meekness part is the part where the other part, kind of wisdom, does not take effect. Meekness of wisdom, self-control, gentle, submissive. And wisdom, this Greek word is sophia, knowledge and practice of the required attributes of righteousness, righteous living. So when you have that as part of you, it's sort of, I don't even say it comes naturally, automatic, because natural is dealing with the flesh, right? Something that's a natural kind of wisdom, but dealing with righteous wisdom is something that is part of you, and it comes out in your works with meekness of wisdom. So you're just plowing right along in your life, you're doing your normal day, and you meet someone and they're talking with you, and you just think it's just going to be, how's the weather in your part of the country? And all of a sudden, they are just blown away, like, oh, you just said something that set me free. I know some of you are too young to understand that. You've not had that experience yet. But when you have the wisdom of God, people will be drawn to that wisdom in you. They're not drawn to you. If they are, that's wrong. But they will be drawn to that. They'll say, I need to know where this water is that I never have to be thirsty again. That's the kind of thing that people do when they're drawn to the wisdom of God. I know several times in my life I have had men that preached, and I'm thinking, that person is on the mark. That person has got it all together. I like the dynamics of his preaching. I like the drama. I like the fanfare that went. I like the way that he would march back and forth. You know, when he was preaching, I like the fact that he kept me captivated. You know, he had charisma. And yet, so many of those men, later on I found out bad things about, that their life was a mess, that they destroyed a church, or they embezzled a lot of money, or they had affairs and broke up their marriage or whatever. That man's life was a mess. And here I was thinking he was, see, I was drawn to the man and not to what he was preaching. And then there would be someone who didn't even use good English. He just did not have an attractive appearance, didn't have fancy clothes. And I might stand by him on the TV or find him on the internet and thinking, I don't think I'm going to listen to this guy. And something would prompt me and say, don't judge a book by its cover, right? And I would go back to that. Or you'd have that old farmer that lives in your neighborhood. He never talks to anybody, but when you go up and talk to him, thinking, who is this man? How does he know this stuff? I know he didn't go to college. How does he know this stuff? How is he so smart? And it's because he has a different kind of wisdom, doesn't he? And he has that meekness of wisdom. He's not self-seeking. He's not presenting it out there that he's so smart. He's just that kind. And so I want to tell you, when you're listening to people, even like myself, I'm not a highly trained person. I've been seeking God my whole life, and I'm still seeking him. I'm still trying to get closer. When you find somebody that is preaching the gospel, don't go for the package. You know what I mean? Don't go for the Bible that has, or the book that has the best looking cover. It's got a flashy front, right? This old worn out book right here, it's really got, I mean, I got pages coming out of the concordance in the back. The cover's broken. I keep it in this cover to protect it and keep it all together. I'm going to be sad today that I have to go to another Bible. Hopefully I can make this one last and take care of it. But I got all my notes in it. I know where everything is, right? And we're that way with people. We like a certain education. I remember a man told me, he said, I like the so-and-so denomination because they require that all their pastors have doctorate degrees. Really? I have to tell you that the denomination he named is in trouble right now. It's a mess because all those men with doctorate degrees have let it get in a mess. All the leadership of that denomination has decided that maybe what we've always believed is not true anymore. Maybe we just need to, we need more people in here, right? Because more people bring more money, and more money means bigger buildings, and bigger buildings means more people in. Hey, it's a big vicious cycle. We get more people in, get more money, build a bigger building. See, that's not the wisdom of God. That's not the wisdom of God. Meekness of wisdom. Verse 14, but if you have bitter envying and strife in your hearts, glory not and lie not against the truth. Get where I can see my notes. Bitter envy and strife, the opposites of a harvest produced from godly wisdom, right? Bitter envy and strife. Envy, jealousy, aroused by something perceived as unjust, indignation. Strife, a desire to put oneself forward, a partisan, fractious, and dividing spirit. One of the things that people of worldly wisdom want to do is they want to divide and conquer. They want to come in, first of all, and elevate themselves and tell you how smart they are. Well, you need to listen to me, right? I got a better plan for the program of this church than the pastor does. I've seen churches divide because some person had come up and he says he's better. Well, that pastor, I can preach circles around him. Well, I got a higher education than that pastor. That pastor, he's not even studying. That pastor, when he get, and you go behind the pastor and you start talking to the congregation. I've seen so many churches split like that, right? And that was part of that strife, a desire to put oneself forward, a partisan, fractious, and dividing spirit. If you got somebody like that, and they're going over here and they're telling one thing, and they're going over here and telling another, that's that strife, isn't it? Envy, jealousy, anger aroused by something perceived as unjust, indignation, envy. So that's persons like, he's got to always be in control. I need people to know that I'm good too. I need people to know that, you know, hey, I can do this better than them. And that's the kind of wisdom that doesn't come from God. He just told us that. Verse 15, this wisdom descendeth not from above, but is earthly, sensual, devilish. Earthly, sensual, devilish. Earthly, sensual, devilish. Those are bad words, aren't they? Earthly, sensual, devilish wisdom. We don't think about wisdom being evil, but you know, the evil one masquerades as an angel of light, doesn't he? And that person can put on a three-piece suit. They can have their hair fixed back. They can be wearing some Italian shoes. they can look prosperous. They have little rings on their hand and show you how wealthy they are. Must be good. He's got a Rolex watch on. Well, you know, that pastor, he has really done good because look how much money he's got in the bank. He drives a Mercedes to the church. That's the church I want to go to. No, that's not the church you want to go to. Right? Don't go to a church where they're showing off how much stuff they have. We've had some really good preachers come out from the country that drove wrecked vehicles and pulled up with blue smoke coming out of their exhaust pipe. And they pull up to the car. You know what I'm talking about? Angie knows what I'm talking about. You know, and that guy gets out and he's maybe his buttons are not buttoned all the way up good, or maybe he's skipped a button and he's got one collar up here. And this guy gets out and bless his heart, his shoes are all worn out. And you find out that this man is not very wealthy, but he sure is wise. Yeah. And when it comes to prayer time, this guy, even in the church, he turns around and gets on his knees. Amen. And he's calling out for help. Right. He just wants help from God. Right. Help me, God. I'm really not worthy to do this. I'm not qualified. I don't know what I need to do, God. I don't even have the words to present it. That's the kind of person you want to follow. Not earthly, sensual, and devilish. Verse 16, for where envying and strife is, there is confusion in every evil work. Envying and strife is those things that bitter envy and strife. In verse 14, he said, where envy and strife is, there's confusion in every evil work. Confusion, selfishness, disorder, right? So the things that may present itself in the beginning as wisdom may not pan out to be that. It might start off good for day one. It may sound good. And as time goes on, it may be proven to be the wrong thing. So many things that we need to follow, we don't have a good yes or no on the first day, right? You meet a person. I don't know if they're going to be good for my life. I don't know if they're someone I need to be friends with. I don't know if there's someone I need to be in business with. It sounds good. I don't know if this woman or this man, this potential spouse for me is a good person, but they sure are cute. I like them. They giggle when I talk to them. They got pretty eyes, right? They smell good. I like that person. And then later on, you find out they don't have a good heart, right? Some of those, the most beautiful and handsome people in the world have a really bad heart, a wicked heart, and you do not want that. Have you ever noticed how so many people in Hollywood and the media and entertainment industry, they go through terrible divorces? Last year just had a terrible divorce that was portrayed on the news. Wow. You know, the case was so big to people that they watched the jury and the trial deliberate in this. And you know what I'm talking about. They got up there, and these two movie stars, so to speak, they got up there and on the stand against each other, and it's like, this is a disaster and you're televising it. This is somebody's tragedy and you're televising it. And people are drawn to that. Wow, I don't want my life to be that way. I'd rather have a quiet little life out in the country than to have some kind of fanfare and be some kind of fire that's going to burn out. Now, before we begin, look at verse 17. Let's flip back to Luke 7:35. Hold your place there. Look at Luke 7:35, a single verse from Jesus. There's so much about wisdom in the Bible, but I just want to give you a few things. Luke 7:35. So just back up and read 31 through 35. And the Lord said, whereunto then shall I liken the men of this generation? And to what are they like? They are like unto children sitting in the marketplace and calling one to another and saying, we have piped unto you and you have not danced. We have mourned to you and you have not wept. For John the Baptist came neither eating bread nor drinking wine, and you say, he hath a devil. The Son of Man is coming, is come eating and drinking, and you say, behold, a gluttonous man and a winebibber, a friend of publicans and sinners. But wisdom is justified of all her children. Now, Jesus just gave two examples. He gave himself and John the Baptist. And the Pharisees didn't like either one. They saw John the Baptist, who was a man of super devout beliefs. He didn't eat, and he didn't drink alcohol. He went out and lived on locust and honey, right? He had clothes of camel's hair, just living in an animal skin. And they said, he's a madman. He's a wild man. And then Jesus came in and he said, Son of Man has come eating and drinking, and you say, behold, a gluttonous man and a winebibber and a friend of publicans and sinners. Well, they just can't be happy, can they? Well, they just wanted to say, you know what, you're cursed if you do and cursed if you don't. And the two men that they picked out as being bad men turned out to be two of the holiest men and the Son of God, right? The Son of God and one of the holiest men that ever lived. So we need to turn the tables in our mind of what we judge as being wise. And then he finishes that by saying, wisdom is justified of all her children. In other words, the fruit. You want to look at a good mother? Look at that mother whose children are well ordered, right? They're in control. The mother that takes care of her children, the mother that produces children. Wisdom is justified of all her children. And again, the works of wisdom prove if it's a good, if it's really wise or not, right? The good mother or the bad mother. Wisdom is justified of all her children. So I want you to realize that there's a fruit here that's involved that you want to look at. And when we look at those things, it helps us to determine, is this the right thing? I have to tell you, I've learned from a lot of you. I've learned from things that you've said. Some of the things that in my life that I've grown in, I have learned that I'm in this situation. I hear somebody say, you know what? This job was offered and I get $5 more an hour in pay, but I'm not going to take it. And I'm thinking, well, I'd jump on that. Right? I mean, that's earthly wisdom. When you say, I would jump on a job for $5 more an hour. Oh, you can double your pay if you do this. Right? It's sort of like saying, you know what? If we go to California and my job, here I make $50,000 a year. I go to California, I make $200,000 a year. Right? Four times I can make in California than what I'm making here. And you load up the truck and you head to Beverly, right? just like the Clampets, you load up everything you got and you say, we're going to California because everything's better there. Well, that's earthly wisdom. You didn't even pray about it. You get to California, you've sold your house. You sold this modest house, $100,000, and you get to California, you can't find anything less than $500,000. What are we going to do now? But we're making $200,000. We're making four times the amount. Yeah, but the house is five times the amount. We've messed up. Right? We're in trouble. Now, I just gave that as an example because there's so many things that you look at that on the surface, it looks good. Right? On the surface, this decision looks right. So you go back to that man that had that opportunity of a job, and he said, you know, I just prayed about that and just got a check in my spirit. There's something wrong with that. You're not looking at the whole picture a lot of times, right? So let's look at Proverbs 9:1 before we go back to James. Proverbs 9:1. And I have to give Angie credit for this because this is something from one of her Bible studies that she studied with the women on Tuesdays. I never try to act like I come up with things on my own if I can give credit to something. I don't want to act like I came up with this, but look at Proverbs 9:1. Wisdom hath builded her house. She hath hewn out her seven pillars. Now, Angie was studying with the ladies about wisdom, and she came to this passage, and she said, wisdom has built her house and hewn out her seven pillars. Well, everybody knows that under this house, some of you younger people might not know, but there's pillars. This house was built on foundation around the outside, but there's pillars down the middle. And the pillars help hold up the house, don't they? So we can't have a board going from that wall to this wall. That's a long way. And the floor would start sagging. So we have pillars here, probably one right down the middle, one right down the middle. I've been under the house many times, and those things go right down the middle of the house. And the pillars. Well, Wisdom's house has seven pillars. That sounds like either a big house or a house that's well built to me, right? Has seven pillars. Well, when Angie was studying, she said that God led her to this next passage in James. So go back to James. We're going to look at what the seven pillars of wisdom are in James 3:17. The seven pillars of wisdom. Everybody back there, James 3:17. But the wisdom that is from above, remember we're talking about worldly wisdom versus God's wisdom. The wisdom that is from above is first pure. I'll just go through this list. Then peaceable, gentle and easy to be entreated, full of mercy and good fruits, without partiality and without hypocrisy. Now, I'm going to show you how you count seven in that, because I went to the original Greek and there's seven topics there. So if you were numbering them, pure is the first one. Peaceable is the second one. Gentle is the third one. Easy to be entreated is the fourth one. That was the way it's read. You could read it one or two ways. Full of mercy and good fruits is one. That's number five. Without partiality is number six, and without hypocrisy is number seven. So let's look at those seven things and see what God's trying to tell us is the wisdom that's from above. First, it's pure. The Greek word literally is men. Like we say men, we're real men, we're manly men. But we're looking here at the word men, M-E-N. That's a Greek word, and it means truly, certainly, surely, indeed. So the wisdom that's from above is truly, certainly, surely, and indeed. It is pure, right? If you go to the store, you'll find products that talk about being pure. This is pure soap, pure milk. You ever had a bottle that said pure milk on it, right? Pure extract, pure vanilla extract. There's a lot of things in the store that says pure on it, right? And when we look at that, we know that we get that and nothing else. There's nothing added to it. There's nothing on the side. It's not vanilla extract with a little dip of chocolate in there. It's not milk with chocolate in there. It's not soap with some scent in there. It's pure. Well, the wisdom that's from above doesn't have any extra stuff with it. It doesn't have things that, you know, well, it's God's wisdom, but I like to throw a little bit of my own stuff in there too. There's only a couple of times in the Bible where somebody gave something extra, and that was Paul, and he told you so in one of the letters to Corinthians. He said, you know, in this, I don't know what God would say, but in my, I'm telling you, this is what Paul would say. And there's very few times, but the Word of God is very clear what it says. It's from God. It's not Paul's opinion. It's not John's opinion. It's not James' opinion. It's not Moses' opinion. It's not David's opinion. It's from God. So the wisdom that's from above begins with pure, truly, certainly, surely, indeed. It's the real deal, right? Nothing added to it. The second thing is peaceable. Irenikos. That sounds Greek, doesn't it? Irenikos. If I saw that on the menu, I'd order it because it sounds good, right? Go to the Greek restaurant, order you some Irenikos. It means peaceable, loving peace peaceable. Well, he just told you that the wisdom from man, the worldly wisdom, is full of bitter envy and strife. Right? So that's the opposite of peaceable. So the second pillar in God's wisdom is peaceable. So anytime using this attribute, anytime that you're looking at someone and you think, that sounds smart, doesn't sound too peaceable though. It sounds wise, but there's something not peaceable about that. Right? So there's a little flag goes up and you say, wait a minute, not peaceable. When he comes into the room and he brings his wisdom with him, it's not peaceable. The third one, gentle. So that I can read my writing. Epiakes is the Greek. Equitable, fair, mild, gentle. So it means gentle. Equitable, fair, mild, gentle. Whenever you see Jesus in your mind teaching, don't go with what you saw on some TV show or a movie or whatever. The Jesus that you need in your mind is the one you get from reading just the Bible, not what Hollywood gave you. Not a long-haired Jesus, because he didn't have long hair, because his word says it's a shame for a man to have long hair. Well, how would Jesus have long hair if his word says it's a shame for that? Right? So he didn't have long hair. He had dark skin, right? Because the place he came from, that's where they had dark skin. But that Jesus was always peaceable, right? You see him one time where he turned over the tables in the temple because of what they were doing. And that's the exception. But I'm glad he did it, aren't you? But he is a peaceable Jesus. Even with the Pharisees, he is very peaceable. He has discussions with them. He doesn't come over and get in their face. He didn't say, I'm the Son of God. This Bible that you're reading, that's my word. He didn't have to. People don't have to defend themselves when they're right. They don't have to get up there and get loud about it. You don't have to. Jesus is peaceable, isn't he? And when you're using God's wisdom, you will be gentle and peaceable. The fourth one, easy to be entreated. Now, we don't use the word entreated very often. That's an old English word. Easy to be entreated. Eupathes is the Greek. Easily obeying, compliant. Now, wait a minute. I thought a person that's wise is supposed to be the one that's doing the teaching. What does that mean, that easily obeying and compliant? You know what? I would step aside if someone had a correction to me, and we do that. We don't have the camera on when we do it, but when it's over with, someone asks for clarification in our service here, we always have a time where you can correct me. Did I miss a scripture or something? And that's the kind of wisdom that the wisdom of God is, right? Easily obeying and compliant. Because I'm just giving what God and the Holy Spirit's given me, right? Through his word. I'm not here to present some doctrine or some denomination or to get you to believe like I believe, or to get you to look like I look, right? I'm not trying to do that. I'm trying to teach you what the Word of God says to the best of my ability. I pray about it, I study it, and I present it, and I hope that I'm easily obeying and compliant to the Holy Spirit and to anyone who maybe could correct me in the Holy Spirit or correct me in love, right? So in other words, it's the kind of thing that you're not demanding you're in charge because you're so wise. Well, God put me in charge, so I'm wise. Maybe he put you in charge to make you wise because you needed a little experience of falling on your face, right? So we need to be humble about it. Number five, full of mercy and good fruits. Full of mercy and good fruits. Eleos is the Greek word. Eleos. Kindness or goodwill towards the afflicted with a desire to help them. a desire to help them. I have seen such love and grace and mercy among the mothers of this family, all of you, and the fathers, of loving your children and being patient with them. Well, when I was a young father, I didn't have much patience. I lost my patience very easily. And I just said, I've told you 3 times, my patience is over with. But you mothers seem to have a little bit of, well, you don't understand she's got a toothache, right? You don't understand that this child was just picked on at school and came home and had a bad day. So they're picking on their siblings. You helped me understand it. Back up and think about it. And there's something going on. Well, in that full of mercy and good fruits, kindness or goodwill towards the afflicted with a desire to help them. So you don't just brush people off because they're a bother to you. When someone really is seeking you, have time for them, right? When someone is asking you, as your neighbor, as your coworker, as your friend at school, as your whatever, however you know that person, as a family member, and they're trying to get your attention, understand that the wisdom of God has kindness or goodwill towards the afflicted and a desire to help them. So that takes the love of God, doesn't it? Because we don't automatically have just like, we just get along with everybody. Those people that present that, we're a religion of peace. Oh, you don't even need God. All you need is love. All the worldly things that they say, they don't pan out. They don't pan out. That stuff of the world, that psychology, you don't need Jesus. You just need to go to a good counselor, right? You just need to go to somebody with a degree. You've got some problems. You just need to go to someone with a counselor. And you probably hated your mother or your father when you were young, and that's probably your problem. Well, it might be part of your problem, but that ain't the solution, right? That doesn't help you. So the wisdom of God says, in each individual situation is different because your Creator made you. You're different. We're all different. The Creator knows you. He knows what you need, not some counselor that says, okay, he's got so-and-so syndrome, and in the book, it says to have him do this. I've had mechanics that do that to my car. Oh, yeah. Tap, 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 tap. That's a valve. Tick, 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 tick. That's an EGR valve. Bang, 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 bang. You're in trouble. You know, we've had mechanics. It's like, oh, yeah, the problem is this. We had a transmission rebuilt many years ago on an old van that Angie drove, and they gave us a 3-month warranty. They rebuilt this transmission. It cost us at that time $1,000. They rebuilt this transmission, and they said, yeah, this transmission, we'll give you 3 months warranty on it. We've rebuilt it. Basically, a new transmission. We've rebuilt it. It lasted 3 months and 1 week, and it started doing the exact same thing again. Wouldn't shift out of the second gear. You could go 30 miles an hour, and that's as fast as you could go in it. So I drove 30 miles an hour back to the transmission place, and I said, you missed it. What do you mean? I said, it's doing the exact same thing before you put $1,000 in it, or before I put $1,000 in it. And his response was, do you live on a hill? And I stopped a minute, and I said, yeah, I live on a hill. He said, that might be your problem, you know, like going up that hill. I thought, do you really think I'm that stupid? Do you really think I'm going to buy that? And I looked at him and I said, do you really think that going, I said, who in Alabama doesn't live on a hill? Right? He didn't know what to do. So he's going to act like, well, it's my fault for driving up a hill. You shouldn't be driving up hills. We can't guarantee. And as I left, I looked at the sign that said Reliable Transmission. That's the name of the transmission place, Reliable Transmission. Now, he didn't have much wisdom with transmissions, but I got wisdom to know that just because it says Reliable Transmission doesn't mean you're going to get a reliable transmission. Maybe what it means is if you're driving by our establishment, you've got a reliable transmission already. If you have to be towed in here, you don't. Maybe that's what it meant. I don't know. So, a kindness or goodwill toward the afflicted with a desire to help them. So, go back to my example of the psychiatrist, and he says, yeah, I'm going to help you because you're paying me $100 an hour for counseling. I'm going to help you. You know, you have to do this. You have to do the work. But you've not helped him, right? That's not wisdom. If I, let's say I have a brown spot on my ceiling. And Angie and I look at it, and we realize it gets bigger every time it rains. What is that telling me? James, what does that tell me? I got a brown spot on the ceiling that gets bigger every time it rains. Rain's coming. It's got a leak in the roof, right? Oh, better get somebody to fix it. So I get somebody to fix it. I have one of the neighbors come in because we, Angie and I, have to go somewhere. So I come back. That brown spot looks beautiful. It's the pebble ceiling is put back. And the next rain I get, it comes back again. And I call the guy up and I say, I asked you to fix this. And he says, well, I did. I painted it. See, all I'm doing is patch the problem. All he's done is made it look right. And he didn't fix the root cause of that problem, did he? He didn't help me. You know what he wanted? He wanted payday. He wanted to get his money and get out of here. Because he can do that with somebody else down the road. He can go to 100 people and paint their ceiling and say, yeah, I fix leaks. No, you don't fix leaks. You fix ceilings. In the meanwhile, we've got a roof leak that's a different level. So you're talking to somebody on the subject of a problem, and you want to deal with what to fix it with. Like this. Someone has a cigarette addiction, and you're going to help them. Well, you know what? They got that nicotine chewing gum, right? They got those patches. Have you tried the patch? But what you need is you need to break that in your spirit. You need to not do that. Oh, you're overeating? Well, you know, they got this diet cheesecake, right? You can go with the low-fat ice cream. You're not fixing the problem, are you? You're trying to help them to get around what the problem, or, you know, giving them a crutch to get around it. So the person that has the wisdom of God, full of mercy and good fruits, kindness and goodwill towards the afflicted with a desire to help them. Number six, without partiality, adiakritos. Adiakritos. I'd order one of those too on the Greek menu. Variance, not being partial or favoristic. Without partiality. So you don't find the easy ones when you've got the wisdom of God. You don't find the ones that, oh, I've dealt with this before. You know, in the years past, my coworkers, we could divvy out tickets at one time, and there was one guy, he'd always get the easy ones, right? Let's see, today we can either change out a computer, which is unplugging and plugging, setting up windows, colors, and things like that, or we've got one that smoke's coming out of it. I'm going to take this one, right? Take the easy one. Well, this is without partiality. So the wisdom from above doesn't pick favorites, right? We don't, they don't have favorite children because they're easy to get along with. We love all our children, right? We're not given favorites in church. We're not given favorites in the body of Christ where we say, we don't like this group over here. You know, these are troublemakers. We don't like them. Without partiality. And the seventh one is without hypocrisy. Anhypocritos. Undisguised and sincere. Undisguised and sincere. So that pretty much tells you what the wisdom of God is. And Jesus said that justified by all her children. Justified by her children. So the wisdom that from above is pure, peaceable, gentle, easy to be entreated, full of mercy and good fruits, without partiality and without hypocrisy. And the fruit of righteousness is sown in peace of them that make peace. Seems like peace is a recurring theme here, doesn't it? There's got to be peace with that wisdom. So I come like an evangelist and I blow into town and I get into behind the pulpit and I start telling you, you're all going to hell. You want revival? You're never going to get it because none of you deserve it. Jesus died on the cross. How dare you? And he starts talking down to people. And when he's over with, everybody shook up. We say, we had revival. I got shook up. That didn't sound like peace to me. That didn't sound like peace. You know, you come in, you say, I know what the Bible says. It says this. Oh, you did that? You're never going to be forgiven of that. I mean, have you ever heard of a sin? And they say, you're never going to be forgiven of that. You did that in your life. You're just going to hell. Well, then why did Jesus die on the cross? If it was all about following the rules and sticking with it and being a perfect person and doing that right, if it's all about that, how dare I come in and tell you, well, if you did you mess up? Okay. Sorry, I can't deal with you. Jesus told Peter he'd have to forgive 70 times 7, right? That's 490 times. You ever had somebody that wronged you 490 times? And 489, you said, one more, right? You know, we treat that like, I'm keeping tabs, 489, buddy, you better not cross me one more time. He was telling us we've got to keep forgiving. We've got to be peaceable. We can't come in, even though our life might be pretty righteous and pretty straightforward, even though we may be living a godly life through years of hard work and experience, it really is not us that did it, right? It's the grace of God that if we are walking the walk. So we can't have no way to come in and judge somebody else and say, you're never going to make it. You failed three times. Three strikes, you're out, buddy. Right? We have to make sure that it's in love. The fruit of righteousness is sown in peace of them that make peace. Blessed are the peacemakers, right? Blessed are the peacemakers. Now, let's finish up with Matthew 7, verse 24. Matthew 7, verse 24. And look at my time. I've gone really long, haven't I? Matthew 7, 24. Some of the children mentioned this. I love that. Therefore, whosoever heareth these sayings of mine and doeth them, I will liken him unto a wise man, which built his house upon a rock. And the rain descended, and the floods came, and the winds blew, and beat upon that house, and it fell not, for it was founded upon a rock. Do you see the wise here? He was wise, wasn't he? And everyone that heareth these sayings of mine and doeth them not, shall be likened unto a foolish man, which built his house upon the sand, and the rain descended, and the floods came, and the winds blew, and beat upon that house, and it fell, and great was the fall of it. So there's the story of the wise and foolish builder. One built his house on a rock, one built his house on the sand. And I always, in my mind, imagine two men that had the same floor plan. They had the same quality building materials, maybe even the same builder. They get a piece of property, one sand, one is on the rock. Well, the sand is like the beach. Well, a lot of people want to live on the beach. I don't. I'm not a beach person. But a lot of people say, oh, yeah, life's a beach, right? We need to go to the beach. We need to make sure we go to the beach three times a year. Oh, I love to listen to the waves. But that house wouldn't last, would it? You ever see hurricanes and the damage they do? There's hurricanes there. The sand shifts around. Those houses have to be built on a slab. If they're not built on a slab, which would be the rock, then they're going to fall apart. The man that built his house on the stone or on the rock, the rain descended and the floods came and the winds blew and beat upon that house and it fell not, for it was founded upon a rock. So the difference is the founding of it. What is it layered on, right? And we talked about having your house built on the rock being what the wise person does. Guess what? It takes longer. You can take your foot and scoop some sand around and lay down a block or lay down a board and go to town building it. And when you get through, you say, look at this great house I built. And you walk through it and it starts feeling like this, you know, because it's not on a rock. You know, if we get up and move around like this, this house doesn't move, does it? It's got a foundation underneath it. Well, I found a song from years past that I used to love to listen to. This was probably in the 80s and 90s. And it was called Two Sets of Joneses. And I was going to sing this, but I think I will help you out and not sing it and just read you the words as a poem, okay? This is a song about two sets of Joneses, Rothschild and Evelyn, Reuben and Sue. And just for discussion through random selection, we've chosen two couples who haven't a clue. Rothschild was lucky to marry so wealthy. Evelyn bought him a house on the beach. Reuben and Sue, they had nothing but Jesus, and at night they would pray that he would care for them each. Evelyn's daddy was proud of young Rothschild. He worked the late hours to be number one. Just newly weds and their marriage got rocky. He's flying to Dallas and she's having a son. Reuben was holding a Gideon's Bible and he screamed, "It's a boy," so that everyone heard. And the guys at the factory took a collection, and again God provided for bills he incurred. And the rain came down and it blew the four walls down and the clouds they rolled away, and only one set of Joneses was standing that day. So what is the point of this story? What am I trying to say? Is your life built on the rock of Christ Jesus or a sandy foundation you managed to lay? Needless to say, Evelyn left her husband, sued him for every penny he had, but I truly wish that those two would find Jesus before things get worse than they already have. When that song plays, I listen to that and I think about, which one am I? Am I the wise person? Am I saying this is the great way because it makes more money? This is the great way because it's quicker, right? The house on sand's quicker. This looks good. If you drive by the house on the sand, it might look beautiful. The people might look so happy out there in it. But when the storm comes, that tells the difference, doesn't it? The storms of life prove which was the right way. Now, you can learn from someone that makes mistakes. You can learn from their mistakes, but probably you're going to learn best from your own, right? Because you don't want to make those mistakes again. You don't want your life to fail. And God gives us a lot of opportunity again and again to learn from that. Go back in your life from when everything was in order and see if you're still there. See if you're still of that mindset. Or have you said, you know what, let's take some shortcuts now. Let's see if we can cut some costs and let's see if we can do it a little different. We used to be part of church. We used to go to church all the time. We used to read our Bibles all the time. We used to pray all the time. But we finally got to where we're pretty good and we don't need that crutch anymore. We finally got to where we know what we're doing, right? And if that's your life, you're headed for a disaster because you've taken the part out of it that worked for you. You've taken the good out that fixed your problems just because, you know, he had a child and the guys at the factory took up a collection. Well, Rothschild and Evelyn's father had the business and Rothschild worked for him and he just worked all the time, right? And their marriage fell apart because Rothschild was never home. But he was making money. He was making money. That's not wisdom, is it? And the wisdom of God, it's not just about spiritual matters. God has given us his word to live a peaceful, happy, joyous life. Right? Of just doing what Jesus said to do. So as I close, I want you to think about your own life. Are you living with the wisdom of God? Or are you living with the wisdom of man? Let's pray. Father, I thank you for your word this morning. I thank you for the peace that we know comes with the real wisdom of God. I thank you that you've given us guidelines to go by. I ask, Lord, that you help us all to be discerning in our spirits, that we might know what the difference in the wisdom is. Things may that someone say to us may sound good. They may have a different method of delivery that we think is so attractive. We may be drawn to people that are charismatic. But Father, I just thank you that you've chosen the prophets who are not always the most popular people, the never the best dressed people, men of God that have a calling on their life. They may not be wealthy. They may not be educated. But Father, very few of the disciples were educated. And we just thank you that you choose common men to present the plan of God. And I just ask, Lord, that the wisdom of God would come through your word and change people's lives today. It's in Jesus' name I ask it. Amen.
Amen.